Let's back up here. How important is this symbolically for the progressive wing of the party? I mean, if you start to look at sort of the map right now, you could go back to Joe Biden as president, right? That's shot number one at progressives. Just look at this campaign year. Terry McAuliffe easily beat back more progressive challengers. I mean, it was a rout. Eric Adams in New York City. You know, at some point, there's a trend developing here, is there not?
Well, and this is a district that voted for Hillary Clinton in 2016 in the primary and voted for Joe Biden in 2020 in the primary. So this is not a quote-unquote Bernie-centric district. Now, of course, that was a much higher turnout, right? And so in a low turnout affair, who is going to turn out? Are they going to be the sort of younger progressive voters who could find themselves coalescing around Bernie Sanders once again? Or is it going to be the more traditional voters, which those are the folks that usually do turn out in elections, right? The folks that are kind of more establishment, that are the kinds of folks that Joe Biden appealed to, that Hillary Clinton appealed to in the first place. But you're right, Chuck, that, you know, this divide that we see on the Republican side, or at least where we see it more cleanly or clearly, just is has not been as big on the Democratic side. In part because, you know, this progressive wing has not been particularly successful, even before Biden, in going after or really spending any money or time or energy in going after, say, more stalwart moderates, right? You never saw a progressive go after Joe Manchin seriously in West Virginia, or Heidi Heitkamp in North Dakota, or Joe Donnelly in Indiana, right? That the intra-party fighting is really relegated to these very blue districts like this one. And so it means that, yes, whoever wins this gets a seat that they can keep forever, but it's not like they are taking out current moderates in swing states with a progressive.